The manhunt for a murderer.
This suspect is at large right now.
Ends right at this woman's doorstep.
I started to scream just to the top of my lungs.
Hear the true story behind the new movie, Captive.
I knew that if I wanted to make it out of there alive, that I better at least do what he says.
And meet the real Ashley Smith.
God came in and said, okay, here's your choice.
On today's 700 Club.
Welcome to the 700 Club, the second Republican presidential debate. It's in the books, but frankly, it seemed like a junior high school mix of angry exchanges between the candidates. And then occasionally, they would actually talk about policy. But it did create some unforgettable moments.
Some of the candidates took aim at frontrunner Donald Trump, while others took on Planned Parenthood, religious liberty, terrorism, and other issues. David Brody brings us the story from Simi Valley, California.
Coming in, the bullseye was squarely on frontrunner Donald Trump. His style is rubbing some of his fellow Republicans the wrong way, and it showed quickly.
I think his response, his visceral response to attack people on their appearance, short, tall, fat, ugly. My goodness, that happened in junior high. Are we not way above that?
I never attacked him on his look, and believe me, there's plenty of subject matter right there. That I can tell you.
And that eventually led to the moment people wanted, Carly Fiorina face-to-face with Trump for the first time since he made a critical comment, wondering if anyone would vote for that face. He says he meant her persona, but Fiorina challenged him.
I think women all over this country heard very clearly what Mr. Trump said.
Trump tried to play nice.
I think she's got a beautiful face, and I think she's a beautiful woman.
But playtime turned mean when they discussed Fiorina's past CEO experience that ended with layoffs and her out of a job.
So I only say this, she can't run any of my companies, that I can tell you.
Politicians have run up mountains of debt using other people's money. That is, in fact, precisely the way you ran your casinos. You ran up mountains of debt as well as losses using other people's money, and you were forced to file for bankruptcy.
Tired of the back and forth, one candidate saw an opportunity and took it.
You're both successful people. Congratulations. You know who's not successful? The middle class in this country who's getting plowed over by Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton. Let's start talking about those issues tonight and stop this childish back and forth between the two of you.
Ms. Fiorina.
But that's Trump's style. And showed it by going after Jeb Bush's brother and former president.
Your brother and your brother's administration gave us Barack Obama because it was such a disaster those last 3 months that Abraham Lincoln couldn't have been elected.
You know what? As it relates to my brother, there's one thing I know for sure. He kept us safe. I don't know if you remember.
Other candidates tried to make their mark over the three-hour event, like Ben Carson, a strong second in the poll.
The pundits forgot about one thing, and that is the people, and they are really in charge.
And Ohio Governor John Kasich had a reminder for everyone.
I'm the only person on the stage and one of the few people in this country that led the effort as the chief architect of the last time we balanced the federal budget.
Mike Huckabee had religious liberty on his mind and the double standard that Christians encounter.
We made accommodation to the Fort Hood shooter to let him grow a beard. You're telling me that you cannot make an accommodation for an elected Democrat county clerk from Rowan County, Kentucky?
A lighter moment came toward the end when the candidates were asked what they'd like to be called by the Secret Service as president. Bush, who's been accused by Trump of having low energy, and Trump, who has a healthy ego, we're both ready.
Ever ready. It's very high energy, Donald.
Mr. Trump?
Humble.
The next GOP presidential debate will be over a month from now, in late October in Colorado. When we hit that debate, we are going to be full into fall. And so then the question becomes, will the summer of Trump become the fall of Trump, or will it become the fall of Donald Trump? David Brody, CBN News in Simi Valley, California.
Well, Terry, you suffered through that three-hour marathon. Did you think anyone came out better as a result?
I don't know that. I think Carly Fiorina scored highly. I think mm-hmm. she presented herself really well, had her facts down. And as someone who is, to some people, fairly unknown, at least as an individual person, I think that was a big score for her. I thought it was more about who didn't come off well than who did, you know? I mean, you've heard them all. I just can't imagine what the next debate's going to cover, except that maybe we'd get some details on some of these programs and plans people have.
Well, I would hope that the party would take it to a level to say, can we have a true debate? And this one, I found myself missing Megyn Kelly because it seemed like the questions were intentionally geared to totally. Get the candidates to these spats.
Yes.
Sparring is probably too gentle a term. Yeah. This went back to childish. And I think the questions were engineered to generate, to produce that kind of thing. And they kept coming back at it. So the question would goad people into these comments. And then the result of the interchange just made... Yeah. It really, I think, diminished the concept of a debate.
You wouldn't mind listening if you felt like there were details being given that were going to cause you to be more well-informed by the end of it. I mean, we've all already heard about everybody's past litany of their accomplishments. It's like, let's talk about today's problems and get on with something that matters, right?
That got through, but you had to sift through a whole lot to get to it. Anyway, there will be more, which is, I don't know if that's good news or not. In other news, an extremely powerful earthquake hit the southern American country of Chile late Wednesday night. Wendy Griffith has that story from the CBN newsroom.
Gordon, the quake in northern Chile was so intense. One man said, I thought it was the end of the world and we were going to die. And it caused buildings to move in the capital city of Santiago. It also led to a tsunami advisory for parts of California and Hawaii. Ephraim Graham has the story.
The 8.3 magnitude earthquake struck just off the coast of northern Chile. But the tremor was so strong, people on the other side of the continent could feel it. Traffic cameras showed the power of the quake, which was followed by four aftershocks above a magnitude of 6. Officials ordered people to evacuate low-lying areas all along Chile's Pacific coast. 1 million residents fled their homes. Authorities say the streets of some coastal towns have flooded.
The water was already coming, but it wasn't a wave. It was like a high tide with force.
The president of Chile asked people who evacuated to stay on high ground.
We are monitoring the situation on the coast in various ways, including through the armed forces. There are planes and helicopters to determine the exact extent of the damage.
The quake raised fears in Hawaii and California. Authorities issued a tsunami advisory and warned of dangerous currents. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Thanks, Ephraim. President Obama and Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu will meet at the White House on November 9th to talk about the nuclear deal with Iran. Politicians from left to right in Israel oppose the deal because they believe it could allow Iran to develop nuclear weapons. It will be the first meeting between the two leaders in months. The Iran nuclear deal, an Israeli war with Hamas, and the rise of ISIS. All of these world-altering events have taken place since Passover of last year. That's when the first in a series of four blood moons appeared in the sky. We're now approaching the last of these blood moons. And as Eric Stackelbeck reports, some believe it could be a signal that God is getting ready to move on the world stage.
It's called a tetrad, four total lunar eclipses appearing in close succession just a few months apart and turning the moon into an eerie blood-red color. These tetrads have been a rare occurrence throughout history, yet we are now in the midst of one. It began in April 2014 on the Jewish holiday of Passover, when the first blood moon appeared. Soon we'll see the final blood moon on September 28th during the Jewish Feast of Tabernacles.
The final blood moon comes as a nuclear deal with the Iranian regime is being finalized, a deal that could lead to a Middle East war.
The day America turns its back on Israel will be the day God turns his back on America. And the day we validate this Iran nuclear deal as signed, sealed, and delivered will be the day we stick our finger in the eye of God.
Pastor John Hagee is author of the best-selling book Four Blood Moons and appears in a recent film of the same name. Hagee believes the current tetrad of blood moons is a sign from God to the world that something major is about to happen involving Israel, with Iran's drive towards a nuclear weapon being a possible trigger.
President Obama says this Iran deal is going to prevent war. Seems like it may be doing the opposite. Do you think we're heading towards another big Middle East war potentially?
What the United States of America has done in the Iran agreement is to guarantee war. Iran has been saying for years, we're going to wipe Israel off the map. They had the will to do it. Now that the Obama administration has paved the way for them to get a nuclear weapon, they've given Iran the power to do it.
Hagee notes that the three previous tetrads of blood moons, all falling on Jewish feast days, have coincided with major events for Israel and the Jewish people. In 1492, the Jews were expelled from Spain, and Columbus discovered America, which would become a safe haven for the Jewish people. In 1948, Israel was reborn as a nation. And in 1967, Israel recaptured Jerusalem during the Six-Day War. Blood moons are mentioned in Scripture, including in the book of Joel, the book of Revelation, and the book of Acts.
The prophet Joel writes the words, "And I, the Lord, will cause the sun not to give its light," that's a solar eclipse, "and the moon shall turn to blood before the great and notable day of the Lord." Genesis 1:14 said God is using the sun, moon, and stars to send signals to mankind. God used the stars to cause the Magi to find Jesus Christ. Joshua, when they were in the Battle of the Five Kings, commanded the sun and the moon to stand still for almost a day.
Hagee believes the current tetrad of blood moons coming during Jewish feast while Israel's enemies are on the march is no coincidence.
The evidence is very clear scripturally that God controls the sun, the moon, and the stars, that God is sending us a signal through the sun, the moon, and the stars. The question is, are we listening?
From Cornerstone Church in San Antonio, Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News.
And Gordon, the fourth blood moon will be on September 28th. That's quickly approaching. What are your thoughts on this?
My thought is we need to pay attention to the calendar of the festivals. And the current festival we're in, this is the Days of Awe, Rosh Hashanah, leading up to Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. And in that, the Jewish people, and I would say all believers everywhere need to follow this. We examine ourselves. We spend time living in tabernacles, understanding that our time here on earth is very short. We are just sojourners here. And are we ready to meet him? And the Vidui prayer that is prayed every Yom Kippur, I encourage everyone to do that inventory. Are you right with God? Are you living in accordance with his precepts? Are you doing things from the heart that are an abomination to him? And if you are, turn from that and turn to him. This is a wake-up call for all of us to say, are we right with God? Are we ready for his return? And if we are, then let's look to the heavens. That's what Jesus said. When you see these various signs, look to the heavens, for your redemption draws nigh. Terry?
Well, up next, meet the Gouda Nuns, 13 sisters who make 20,000 pounds of cheese. Find out what secret ingredient makes their product a sellout after this.
Well, it's a business model you won't see anywhere else. 13 nuns who make cheese, and they sell out every year. So what's their secret ingredient? Heather Sells traveled to their monastery in Virginia to find out.
This is the heart of this cloistered Trappist nun community, gathering for worship and prayer seven times a day, starting at 3:15 in the morning. And this is the cheese barn, where the 13 sisters at Our Lady of the Angels make 20,000 pounds of Gouda every year. Most of their $250,000 business is mail order, although some local shops drive out monthly for the cheese their customers crave.
The flavor's great. It's on the mild end in terms of intensity, but it's delicious and really versatile. You can use it for cooking, or you can just nosh it with salami and olives and bread.
When they started, the nuns knew nothing about how to make cheese. Today, they literally cannot keep up with the demand from food connoisseurs around the country.
It sort of sells itself. People get it as a gift, and they call and they say, could I order some of this cheese?
Sister Barbara is one of the original six who was sent by a large monastery in Massachusetts to start anew on this gorgeous piece of land near Charlottesville, Virginia. The goal, follow the centuries-old rules of St. Benedict by building a life based on prayer and engage in manual labor to support themselves. Happily for the sisters, the property they bought already featured a cheese-making facility.
We were so naive, we thought it'd be so simple. You have some of this equipment here, and you just get some milk and a few lessons and just make some cheese.
But the sisters persevered, and they got it right, really right. They allot 32 days a year to make the Gouda, and everyone pitches in. Sister Maria is the designated cheese cook. The 35-year-old from Spain must manipulate some 6,000 pounds of pasteurized milk with a little culture and rennet into several hundred wheels of cheese. It looks easy, but like any good recipe, it's all about precision, getting the correct temperature, cutting the curds at just the right moment, heating them, then draining the whey, and finally pressing the cheese. Over the years, the sisters have not only perfected their technique, they've never bungled a batch. That's almost unheard of. Sister Linda is sidelined from the cheese making with an injury right now, but says her fellow sister's attention to detail is key.
A big part of it has been their openness to learning and their absolute dedication to it. Doing it better.
The sisters say prayer is also a big part of their work, from making the cheese to shipping it out.
While I'm doing it, I'm really praying for the people who are gonna eat that cheese. I mean, I know every family, every person have problems.
For every five cheese orders that come in the mail, at least one, maybe out of every four, one will have a request for prayers.
Prayer is also the reason the nuns say they won't grow their business.
People will come in and say, well, you sold out last year, so you're going to make more next year, aren't you?
The priority is not the cheese. That's not why we're here.
What is happening here? A seeking after the Lord that is visibly discernible.
It's fun to see the nuns, and they're so, kind and calm and mellow. It sort of slows you down a little bit.
People come to the door, come to buy cheese. They always want to know a little bit about our way of life, so we tell them. And then we ask them if they'd like to stop in the chapel for a moment.
When they're not in the chapel or making the cheese, the nuns do admit to eating it often. And there is a preferred method.
My favorite way to have it is on a piece of toast for breakfast.
If you toast a piece of bread so that the bread is kind of crispy, and then you put a couple thin slices of cheese on, put it in the microwave for 25 seconds.
So what's next for the sisters? No cheddar or Havarti, they say. It's strictly Gouda. As for their numbers, it's clear a new generation is needed sometime soon. But these women believe if they remain true to their calling, God will replenish their ranks in His time.
We are here together because God called us here one way or another. We all followed what we perceive to be God's call to us individually. We never knew each other before, so it's not a coincidence, but part of a larger plan that remains a mystery.
It is a beautiful, holy mystery that's unfolding here as the sisters seek out God and find ways to minister through simple 2-pound wheels of cheese. Reporting in Crozet, Virginia, Heather Sells, CBN News.
Well, we are going to have a taste test. And Terry from Wisconsin, who knows her cheese.
And an avowed cheesehead.
You're being prayed over right now, you know that.
Oh, my word.
You like?
Come on.
Okay, that can go home with you,
Wow. I'll take it.
You'll take it?
Well done, sisters, well done. Want you to know, every year the nuns sell out of cheese well before Christmas. So if you want to buy some for holiday gift giving, go to our website, cbn.com, for more information. It's creamy, it's tasty, it's wonderful. Have some.
Have some.
I'll go to this next break while you eat.
All right.
Okay. Then I'll eat. Okay.
Then you'll eat some more. And then we'll eat again.
Up next, the true story that inspired the upcoming movie Captive. Ashley Smith tells what really happened to her at the mercy of a cold-blooded killer.
I was like, this is it. He's going to take me up first, rape me, and then strangle me. That's it.
I knew that if I wanted to make it out of there alive, that I better at least do what he says.
Watch her miraculous escape when we come back. Well, this week we've been celebrating our annual 7 Days Ablaze. Yesterday, during noon chapel, we prayed for all of the requests that our partners and viewers have sent to us. And best-selling author Jonathan Kahn was our featured speaker. Take a look.
I give you a word of encouragement. The word of encouragement is this: when you're in God's will and all hell is going against you, don't be discouraged, be encouraged, because there's something big coming, something good coming. Push on, put break through, and it's gonna happen. Push on.
Let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you that you hear us when we come in your righteous name. Thank you for what you're doing in the lives of people that have contacted us, and we join in covenant with them today.
I love these times of prayer. It really helps us to focus on the power and the presence of God available to all of us. 7 Days Ablaze continues throughout the week. If you haven't sent your prayer request to us yet, all you have to do is dial the number that you see on your screen. It's 1-800-759-0700, or you can log on to cbn.com. We would love to pray for you. We also invite you to join us for our service chapel today. Gordon is our featured speaker, and we're going to be streaming that service live on cbn.com. That happens at noon Eastern time, so join us. Wonderful opportunity to really focus on God's presence in your life. Well, right now we have an incredible story for you. In March 2005, Brian Nichols held Ashley Smith hostage in her apartment for 7 hours. After shooting 4 people in Atlanta. Ashley's miraculous relief made headlines worldwide, and now her true story has been made into a movie called Captive. In this interview with reporter Tim Branson, Ashley tells what happened that fateful night in an amazing testimony to the power of prayer.
We're just running around and saying, get out of the courthouse, get out of the courthouse.
The scene inside Atlanta's Fulton County Courthouse was chaotic and bloody. A man allegedly overpowered a courthouse deputy who was escorting him to his rape trial. He took the deputy's gun, then shot and killed the judge and court reporter.
The suspect is at large right now. He is identified as Brian Nichols.
Police launched a massive manhunt. As news spread, residents locked their doors and waited. At around 2 a.m. in northern Atlanta, Ashley Smith had just returned to her apartment after making a late-night run to a convenience store. It was then she noticed a suspicious-looking man sitting in his car.
She felt uneasy, so she jumped out of her car and hurried to her apartment. She put the key in the lock, opened the door, and the stranger was right behind her.
I started to scream just to the top of my lungs, and he came up to me, shut up, shut up, and just point the gun at me. Just shut up, don't scream. If you don't scream, I won't hurt you. So I stopped screaming, and he pushed me in the house and shut the door and locked it. And I just knew that I wasn't gonna make it out of there. I knew I was gonna die. But I immediately said, God, look, he can rape me. He can do whatever he wants to me. Just let me walk out of here alive.
Inside, he told Ashley he was Brian Nichols, the man police had been looking for.
He had already killed 3 people to my knowledge, and he wasn't gonna stop. I immediately started praying silently to God, just please get me out of here alive. I've been through so many things in my life. I will get through whatever happens to me. Just please do not let him kill me.
Nichols made her sit in the bathtub and left the room. He returned with a roll of tape.
When he came back with the tape, I was like, this is it. You know, he's just going to strangle me with the, he had an extension cord too. He's going to strangle with me with the extension cord, or he's going to tape me up first, rape me, and then strangle me. That's it. I knew that if I wanted to make it out of there alive, that I better at least do what he says.
For Ashley, that meant overcoming years of addiction to meth. She had been getting help and had turned to God, but she couldn't make a clean break until now.
He asked if you had any pot to smoke. Tell me about that. Tell me what happened.
He asked me if I had any. I said, no, but I've got some ice. It was like God came in and said, okay, here's your choice. You can say no, and you can live on doing great things that I have planned for you. Or you can live this miserable, miserable life that you've been living. Immediately, I said, no, that was the time for Ashley to wake up and to start living her life again instead of continuing to die slowly.
Nichols snorted the meth and untied Ashley. She started telling him about her life, her struggles, and her five-year-old daughter. She also read to him from a book she had been reading called The Purpose-Driven Life by Pastor Rick Warren. Nichols seemed to relax as she talked. Then he asked Ashley what he should do.
For him to ask me, what do you think I should do? I wasn't going to hold back. What do I think? Do you really want to know? Is what I thought to myself. Do you really want to know? Do you want to know? So I told him, I think you should turn yourself in. He said, I have a demon inside of me. So the whole spiritual warfare, I could get that. I could definitely see that he was being pulled one way or two different ways.
Then finally, after 7 hours, Nichols let Ashley go. She drove off in her car and called 911.
911, what's your emergency?
When police arrived, Nichols turned himself in and would be sentenced to life for the murder of four people. For Ashley, her experience as a hostage helped her find freedom, because not only did she give up drugs, she committed her life fully to Jesus Christ. Later, Ashley learned she was never alone on this journey. The women in this prayer group had been praying for her for 6 years, including her Aunt Kim.
We were asking God to free her. I mean, that was just our heart's cry, that we wanted her free from this, that we wanted her to see how much God loved her. And I think we were just crying out for the freedom of this addiction and for her to see God.
We would ask God to show off.
Right.
I mean, those are direct quotes sometimes in our prayer. Be big, show off. Sure. You know, show your power, show your glory.
And that he would do something that would get her attention. And he did.
In time, Ashley put her life back together. She's learned that when she prays, God is with her and always will be.
My future is so much brighter now because I have a personal relationship with Jesus. And that makes it, that makes my world and my future so much brighter.
Personal relationship with Jesus changes everything. And today we want to go before the Lord, the one who has the power to change our circumstances, to fill our hearts, to heal our wounds, with your prayer requests. We want to pray for you. Many of you have sent in prayer requests during this time. Here's someone asking for healing from severe fibromyalgia. Says, my husband is leaving me because I'm sick. Someone else saying, I'd ask for prayer that my children will love Jesus with all their heart, soul, and mind. Someone saying, a miraculous healing of my aorta trivalve. And then someone else saying, I need financial help. Please pray for me.
And here's one, healing of type 2 diabetes, and then successful sale of my home. I cannot afford to be a homeowner any longer. That I may walk in the supernatural with God's wisdom. That's a great prayer request. And then restoration of my 22-year marriage. Let's bring these to the Lord and realize the power of prayer. That was a wonderful prayer meeting that was going on in that woman's life, behind the scenes, asking God to show off, to come in big. And just imagine that there are people right now watching this show, praying for you, creating a great circle of prayer, asking God to show up big, to show off, to show His great power towards you. Now, what does it take to get that? What does it take to have miracles come into your life? Well, number one, you need to be right with God. You need to turn. You need to say, okay, I'm willing to turn. And that's what she did. It was a moment of absolute terror for her, but she says, I want God. I want to follow His way. I want to do it His way. And she turned, and then God showed off big. You don't have to bargain with Him. You don't have to say, I'll make some kind of deal. That's not how this works. All you have to do is believe that He wants to forgive. He wants to restore. He wants to answer your prayer. He wants to be your all in all. He wants to show up big for you. That's all you have to do. So let's pray and let's believe and let's let God do all the rest. Pray with us. Lord, we lift the needs of the audience to you, and first and foremost, we come to you. In these days of awe, we turn our hearts to you and we ask that you forgive. We ask that you forgive us, for out of our own hearts have come the things that you despise. And so we ask now that you would restore us, that the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight. Take these things away from us, God. We turn from them now. We turn to you, and we ask for your salvation and your joy and your restoration. And now, through the righteousness of Christ given to us, we come boldly to your throne of grace. And for those who are asking for needs now, for those who are asking for healing in their body, we ask for you to be Jehovah Rapha, the Raphael, the healing of God, would be released throughout their bodies now in Jesus' name. There's someone, you've had recurring sinus headaches. They're deep sinus headaches, not just in your forehead, but in your cheeks, even around your ears, and you are suffering with continual pain. God is healing you right now. He's restoring all of that. You've been healed now in Jesus' name.
Terry? Someone, you've aspirated something very damaging, and it's caused you a lot of pain in your breathing. God is healing that for you right now. Your lungs will clear up, that pain will go away, you'll be refreshed as you breathe. And someone else, you have a problem with your bones, very brittle, very unbending. You've had issues with that. God is healing and strengthening your bones now. In Jesus' name, just receive that.
Lord, we now pray for those who are asking for their marriages, asking for their children. And Lord, we ask that husbands would turn to wives and love them as you have loved the church, that wives would turn and respect would be renewed. Lord, we ask for children that their hearts would turn to their parents, that there would be restoration of families throughout the land. And for finances, Lord, you provide for your people. And so we ask for abundance, we ask for provision, we ask that you supply their every need according to your riches and glory. Do it, Lord. Show yourself. Show your glory. Reveal your glory to the nations. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you need prayer, we're here for you. This is our week of prayer, and you can easily ask for prayer by just picking up the phone and calling. 1-800-759-0700. We've had almost 100,000 prayer requests during this time, and you can join. Every day, the staff will gather, and we'll pray for each one. So please, if you want prayer, give us a call. 1-800-759-0700. Terry?
Well, we showed you a little clip from the movie Captive, based on Ashley Smith's true story. That film opens in theaters nationwide on Friday, and on tomorrow's 700 Club, Ephraim Graham will take us behind the scenes of Captive. Still ahead on today's show, her parents were told to prepare for her funeral.
From daylight till dark, I was a needle junkie, so my arm had swelled up the size of a grapefruit.
See what saved this young woman's life. That's coming up later.
And welcome back to the 700 Club. The Obama administration's plan to train fighters from Syria to fight ISIS is a, quote, total failure. That's the opinion of some senators on the Armed Services Committee. The plan was to put more than 5,000 Syrian fighters on the battleground by the end of the year. But the top general in charge of fighting ISIS told the committee only 4 or 5 fighters are actually involved in the battle.
I must say I've been a member of this committee for nearly 30 years, and I have never heard testimony like this. Never.
Last week, 2 senior intelligence analysts accused higher-ups of editing the reports to make it seem like the fight against ISIS is going better than it really is. The former secretary of the Nobel Peace Prize Committee says the 2009 award to President Obama failed to live up to the panel's expectations. He says that the committee expected the prize to give a boost to Obama. Instead, it was met with fierce criticism in the U.S., where many people argued that Obama had not been president long enough to do something worthy of a Nobel Peace Prize. And he says even many of the president's supporters believe the prize was a mistake. And you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com. Gordon and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
In parts of Peru, people still cook their meals in a pit stove. And for one family with a young child, just making dinner proved to be dangerous.
4-year-old Percy was in such a hurry to run outside, he didn't realize he'd come too close to the fire pit the family used for cooking. His foot hit the corner of the grate, and a pan with boiling oil flipped up and hit him.
I get burned on my back with oil from the pan.
I heard a scream, and then I saw the empty pan. I ran through the door and saw Percy rolling on the ground.
Percy received second and third degree burns from the boiling oil. At first, his mother took him to this local clinic, but the nurse there knew he needed more care than she could give.
They told me the wound was very serious and that I had to take him to the regional hospital.
The government-run hospital allowed Percy to stay for free, but the family still had to pay for medicine. When their money ran out, Percy's treatment stopped. He was now at risk of getting a serious infection.
The doctor told me I had to buy more medicine that day. I told him I didn't have money because my husband was out of work. I felt so alone.
That's when Operation Blessing came and bought all the medicines Percy needed to complete his treatment. That included antibiotics and other creams, which prevented infection and helped to heal his skin. As you can see from these pictures, Percy has almost completely recovered from his injury.
My back doesn't hurt or itch anymore.
We also took steps to make sure Percy's home was safe. We built a 20-foot extension onto their tiny house. Then we built them a new kitchen, equipped with a new 3-burner portable propane stove. The space will provide a safe place for them to cook and will be a place for Maha to start a small cafe when the time is right.
Thank you, Operation Blessing, for the medicines and a safe stove for me and my children.
Thank you. If you're a member of the 700 Club, you're part of blessing that family. If you're not a member, join us. A portion of every gift goes into the work of Operation Blessing. Another portion goes into the work of CBN International to preach the gospel around the world. And you're a part of all of it when you join the 700 Club. How much is it? It's just $20 a month, 65 cents a day. And when you join, ask for Pledge Express. That's electronic monthly giving where the bank does all the work. You don't have to write any checks. The bank takes care of all of it. We save so much on the processing, we can send as our gift to you, Power for Life, monthly teaching CDs. So if you'd like those, ask for Pledge Express when you call. Or just log on to CBN.com, and when you join monthly on the internet, you automatically sign up for Pledge Express. So do it now. 1-800-759-0700. Terry?
Well, up next, a woman remembers the nightmare of her drug addiction.
I lived in these crack motels, lived in abandoned buildings, lived, you know, sometimes out of my car, and would just, from daylight till dark, I was a needle junkie.
Stay tuned to see how a prayer sets her free. at Amy Lambert today, you would never guess that she was once holed up in a crack motel on the verge of dying. Amy is now a healthy, beautiful young woman, all thanks to the power of prayer.
Most drug users don't plan on becoming addicts, but it happens all too often. Amy Lambert was stunned when it happened to her. Her story begins when she was 10. She grew up in a Christian home. Then, her parents divorced.
Tears are flowing down my face, and I didn't really understand what was going on, but all I knew was like my whole world was falling out from underneath me. And I went through just a whirlwind of emotions. There was a lot of anger, a lot of bitterness, and mainly, you know, the anger that I had in my heart, I mainly turned it towards God more than anyone else.
And her anger led to something more.
There was something on the inside of me that just became filled with rebellion. And I ran away from God as fast as I could run away from Him. And I wanted nothing to do with Christians or Christianity or church. I just wanted to be completely done with it.
She reached out to her friends who had a ready solution.
I stayed at one of my friend's house and we snuck out of the house. We met up with some boys out in a field in the middle of nowhere. And the first thing that I did was prescription drugs. They had pain pills. But I didn't know how to deal with all the emotions that I had inside. And so to do drugs was a way of escape. And by the time I was 13 years old, I was introduced to cocaine, marijuana, LSD, basically anything I could get my hands on. And it was a very quick progression.
She made it through high school, hiding her drug use from her parents. She moved out after graduation, and it wasn't long until she found even harder drugs.
My drug addiction escalated to a point where I would literally inject anywhere from 20 to 30 times a day. I mean, it was just such a dark, dark period in my life. The times where I lived in these crack motels, lived in abandoned buildings, lived, you know, sometimes out of my car, and would just, from daylight till dark, I was a needle junkie. I wasn't a party girl, I was a needle junkie. And I used in order to survive. And I remember, you know, looking at people that would be in the grocery store and looking at people on television, and I would so envy them because they were normal and they could function without having to wake up and put a needle in their arm.
Amy became a dealer, but it wasn't enough to support her habit, so she exchanged sex for drugs.
I think about being this young teenage girl who got involved with a drug dealer that was about 55 years old, and he basically became my sugar daddy. And there were moments in the darkness that only God knew about where I would cry. I would literally be in these moments where tears would be coming down my face and I would be in the moment and in my heart, I would be saying, God, rescue me from this. I do not want to live this lifestyle. I felt so degraded. I felt less than human, didn't deserve to be alive. But I would still, through my tears in the darkness, I would cry out to Him to save me.
One night, Amy tried to shoot up, and she completely missed the vein.
So my arm had swelled up the size of a grapefruit, and I had to call my mom on Monday morning and say, you need to come and pick me up, I'm in bad shape. They put me into the emergency room, the doctors ran tests on my body, and they brought my family into a room and they said, of the stages of drug addiction, your daughter is at the last stage before death, and you guys need to prepare for her funeral.
Doctors operated on Amy's swollen arm, and she had to stay in the hospital for a week. While she was there, a group of women from a nearby church paid her a visit.
They just started ministering to me. And one lady in particular, who would later become my spiritual mother, she said, Amy, can I pray for you? And I said, yes, I had nothing left to lose. And when she began to pray, it was like God downloaded the message into her. Things that there's no way that she could have known about. She started to read my mail. And although I was 19 years old, I was street hard, I learned how to survive. It was like deep on the inside, I was just a broken and hurting little girl. And I'll never forget her asking me the question, and it was so powerful to me because I had that church background, and for years of my life, I thought I was okay because I knew in my head, John 3:16, I knew that Jesus died on the cross for my sins, but it was like God pulled the veil off of my eyes. And I realized in that moment, I am so lost. And she said, Amy, are you ready to surrender your life to Jesus Christ? And I called on the name of Jesus and I meant it with all of my heart. And that was the beginning of my road towards transformation.
Amy committed to a one-year recovery program at Mercy Ministries in Louisiana.
Before I came into the program, I remember feeling like I didn't care whether I lived or died. I just had this like this guilt and this shame that just hung on me. But I came to this realization, no, he really does have a hope and a future for my life.
5 years later, after working with several other ministries, Amy started her own recovery outreach, Hope Uprising. She speaks to thousands of young people every year who are hungry for the life-changing message of the gospel.
When I tell you right now, the greatest decision I ever made was to give Jesus everything, the good, the bad, and the ugly.
I remember many nights where I would be in these crack motels and I flip on the television and there's Christian television and it was like penetrating me. It was speaking directly to me. And one thing that I can say is that you are turning on this television broadcast for a reason and for a purpose. And if Jesus Christ can save my life and deliver me from multiple addictions, then he can do the same thing in your life.
Did you hear what Amy said? She had church background. She had memorized. She knew John 3:16. She knew that Jesus was the Son of God, that he had died for her sins. You know, she had just enough knowledge to make her feel a little bit safe while she was completely and wholly lost. I speak that to you today because I think in the church, in people who think they are a part of the church today, there's a lot of knowledge about God. I want you to know it's not about knowledge. The Bible says even Satan knows that Jesus is the Son of God. Just to know that, to acknowledge it, to believe it, isn't enough. You have to receive it. You have to do what Amy did. You have to say, yes, God, I know what you've planned and purposed for my salvation. I know I need it. I am a sinner in need of a Savior. And today, Jesus, forgive my sins. Become my Savior. Be the Lord of my life. You know, we had Max Licato on earlier this week, and he was talking about living in our glory days now, not defeated and depressed and discouraged by the muck and the mire in our hearts and lives and around us, but living in the glory days. He said there was one necessary thing to do that, to turn away from the wilderness when we turn to Jesus Christ. If you're not experiencing the love, the forgiveness, the peace, and the joy that Jesus Christ offers today, I want to suggest to you that you have not turned away from the wilderness, that you have focused on things other than the mighty God we serve, the one who has the power not just to forgive your sins, as amazing as that is, not just to save your soul, but to address every single need in your life right now, today, here, to be more than enough for everything that your heart is crying for. Ask. Ask. You saw Ashley Smith's story. Ask. You just saw Amy Lambert's story. Ask. Get down on your face before the living God and ask. Jesus, will you be the Lord of my life, the Savior of my soul? It's called surrender. It's saying, I have come to the end of myself. I can't do this. And more significantly, I don't want to do this without you. I want to know you. I want to love you. I want to serve you. And I need so much, God. Change the way I think. Change the way I hear things. Change the way my eyes perceive things. Change my heart so that I can follow you your way, not my way with just a little bit of you. I want all of you. And I want to give you all of me. It's the secret. It's the secret. You've been told over and over just throughout our program today, do something about it. Do something today to let Jesus become all he wants to be in your heart and life. And listen, if you want to pray with someone, you can call the toll-free number coming up on your screen, 1-800-759-0700. The friend answering that phone is somebody who's already surrendered, already prayed that prayer, and it'd make their day if you'd call them today and ask them to pray with you. We want to leave you with these words from Joel 2:32. encouraging words for everyone to hear. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Let that be you today if you haven't done that already. We continue to pray for you throughout this week and invite you to join us. We'll see you again tomorrow right here on the 700 Club. Till then, God bless you.